Hi, I'm Aprille Joy Ericsson, and welcome to Innovation Squared.
Hi, I'm Rob Lenz, and welcome to Innovation Squared.
So, hi, Rob. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
My friends all call me Aprille, even though the spelling is Aprille. Students call me Dr. E. So, Dr. Lenz, what's your way you'd like me to address you for today?
Yeah, Dr. Lenz is my dad. So I think you can call me Rob. All my friends and colleagues call me Rob, and then my parents call me Robert, which generally means, you know, I've done something wrong. So Rob would be great.
So I just wanted to ask you one of the first questions, which is, professionally, what you're focusing on at this moment?
I work within a company called Amgen. It's a biotech company. We focus on developing medicines to treat patients with serious disease. I'm in the clinical development space, so responsible for the clinical trial component of it. And so a lot of what we're focused on is driving innovation into our clinical trials. And that includes, you know, innovation around designing our trials, driving innovation in how we actually execute our clinical trials.
What really deems what's successful for you?
Yeah, I mean, at the highest level, right, we want to be delivering highly effective medicines for patients. You know, we're focused on a number of diseases like cardiovascular disease and oncology, and these are areas where quite literally patients' lives are at stake. And so success for us is, are we delivering meaningful improvements on current standards of care for patients? That's really the ultimate, I think, standard by which we measure ourselves and deem success. And then, you know, within the clinical trial space, again, a lot of it has to do with how quickly can we deliver these medicines. You know, historically, the drug development process takes a decade and a half, and within clinical development, it may take 7 or 8 years on average. And you know, these are patients that can't wait 7 or 8 years, to be quite honest. These are patients that need these therapies now. Quite literally, their lives are depending on it. And so a lot of what we've been focusing in on is accelerating those development and ultimately access to those medicines to patients, and then doing it in as an efficient way as possible, so that we can, you know, evaluate a number of medications. Unfortunately, most of what we study won't ultimately work, and so it's critical for us to, you know, suss out those that look the most promising as early on as possible.
I understand.
One of the areas that I feel like I got a little inspired from your area, one of the areas we're focused in on is how do we optimize these trials, you know, as I talked about. And one of the ways we've been doing is simulating the trials before we start it. And I always thought that this is analogous, perhaps, you know, inside the walls of NASA, as you guys contemplate launching a multi-$100 million rocket into space. You know, you don't just shoot it up and hope that it works. I'm sure you simulate the performance under, you know, wind conditions and humidity and velocity.
Oh yeah, for sure. The simulation part was something that I started off doing when I used to do attitude control systems and developing spacecrafts, how we control their motion and their ability to survive in the extreme environments of space. We do rely heavily in my industry on simulation, but there's nothing like the real thing. So we try to test as we are going to fly, or test as we think is going to be the best experiment, you know, the representation of what we'll experience. And so the two must go hand in hand, just as you know in your own field.
Absolutely. Yeah, you know, we do basically the same thing, except it's just applied to our clinical trials, because they may perform thousands of different ways depending on, you know, the patient population, where around the world we conduct our clinical trials. And, you know, we use mathematical simulations, which is a kind of a new thing within our industry. One of the challenges we've had in the clinical trial space is we tend to have historically these very discrete tests, very expensive experiments, big trials, and then you'd only sort of learn at the end of that trial. And then you'd say, invariably, there's things you wish you had done differently in terms of the trial design or the patient population, right? And so one of the things we've been thinking about, you can look at that performance of the drug or the trial and then make modifications to that ongoing trial. So it's a much more, you know, iterative sort of optimization or adaptation. That's something we call adaptive trials. So.
It's very similar in my, when I reflect on like aerospace engineering and generally in engineering. Well, we start off really with brass boards and what we call engineering models. And we try to really sort of hone out the concept and make sure that it's going to at least perform close to what we expect.
You've sort of forged the way for many others behind you. You seem like you've got a litany of firsts. So it's quite impressive.
Thank you. When I reflect on myself as a kid, I was like this tomboyish girl who didn't let the boys tell her no, she couldn't play. And I was willing to, you know, best them. If I wasn't as big or strong as them, I could use my brain. And those things, I think, helped to hone this sort of persona of like, I could do anything. And I like the challenges of being the first one to finish in class, having the top scores. When I found out that I was first in some categories, it was never really the reason for doing it. It sort of happened because I had this desire to do the best, to be the best, regardless of, you know, the color of the skin, my gender, the community I came from.
Well, as the father of a 13-year-old girl who creates stress from now and then, as I'm sure you're familiar with. No, it's a great inspiration. I'll make sure she watches that part of it.
I wanted to ask you, who maybe was an influence for yourself? Maybe you could share who were those figures and what was special about them?
Yeah, someone that had, you know, had particular influence, I think, on me as a scientist was my PhD advisor. He really instilled in me a sense of scientific discipline and rigor that I still use today. It also, I think he, you know, instilled in me that healthy degree of skepticism that I think all scientists have to some extent, much to the, you know, chagrin of my family. You know, and then he just had this sort of a thirst for scientific knowledge that couldn't be quenched. How about you? Who did you have anyone in particular that stands out for influencing you?
My mom, you know, yes. She's just a go-getter, and she put herself through college with us as young girls. My grandparents also really played a huge role, because at the time I didn't realize, like, they were, both of my grandfathers are engineers, and the women, a number of my great aunts are educators, and I had one aunt who, she was a librarian, and she would take me to the Brooklyn Public Library where she worked. So I had a love for books. Maybe this is a good time, but do you have a favorite quote?
But one of it's from the famous astrophysicist Richard Feynman. You may be familiar with it. You know, for a successful technology, reality must take precedence over public relations, for nature cannot be fooled. To me, it's a constant reminder that we need to ground ourselves and our beliefs in science. As a scientist, I believe that to my core. You know, and the business that I'm in, which is we're developing medicines that are gonna go into thousands, if not tens of thousands of patients. We have the trust of our patients. We have to be completely grounded for the entirety of that process in science and never stray from that. How about you?
I think that there are many people that use this quote in a similar way, but I love to inspire people by saying, shoot for the moon, and even if you miss, you'll still be amongst the stars. And it's really, to me, about choosing lofty goals and really pushing your hardest to get them. But if it's not attainable, then you've at least pushed yourself past maybe sort of just the menial task of everyday living. But I've been gravitating more to things like, you know, that are more about diversity and inclusion. So I have this one that I say that when diverse ideas collide, they spark innovation. You know, we have these very diverse ways of thinking, or the way we approach problems, or the problems that we're even trying to solve. But yet there's an opportunity when we collide with our thoughts, there's enough space for everyone. You can tell that space with the capital S, because when you look out into the celestial heavens, I mean, it's just vast. And So how could we not be sort of inclusive and involve everybody?
It's interesting, the parallels in our industry, because a lot of things we talk about are the competition in the space with other companies. And I always try to ground people that, look, the real competition are the diseases that we're trying to cure, or right? The cancer is the competition. It's not the other companies that are like Amgen. Try to always find silver linings from COVID, which is, you know, no small feat these days. But one of them is it really kind of catalyzed the medical community, and that's the public sector and the private sector coming together in ways that we really hadn't before. And the other thing, obviously, COVID's done is it's highlighted some of the, you know, the racial disparities. Those were always there. I've seen it catalyze a lot of action on behalf of companies, also the regulatory authorities, right, who are, you know, collectively were saying, okay, what can we do to ensure that patient populations that are typically under or historically underrepresented in our clinical trials. Innovation is obviously core to what you do, right? And you've been involved with a number of innovative accomplishments. You know, what's the one thing that you think you're the most proud of with as it relates to innovation?
So I ended up being this instrument manager for the ISAT-2 mission, and we have only one instrument called Atlas. And it uses some techniques that I've done on another mission called Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. There's a laser altimeter called LOLA on the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. And this basically is a laser that's pointed down to the surface. And when it rebounds back up into the telescope and the detector, you are measuring the time that it takes to travel to get the distance. So with LOLA, we were able to create, you know, these three-dimensional maps of the moon's surface. If you know the Apollo days, they really didn't have those capabilities. They kind of were looking out the window and say, okay, all right, let's kill the jets and hope they don't land in a crater, right? And now we've got the moon mapped out to like 3 centimeters in resolution, which is phenomenal. The map just looks awesome from LOLA. You know, it's working just so well that I'm just really, really proud of the team. It was really a hard mission.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Wow, that's phenomenal.
You know, when you talk about how long it takes you to solve, you know, these problems with viruses and diseases and other things like that, I think, and I went, yeah, it takes us a long time too.
You know, I'm sure, like me, you're motivated by those daily interactions with the people that are within NASA. I know for me, it's, you know, people ask what's unique about where I work, and I'm sure they ask you the same thing. And in the end of the day, it's the people. It's just the day in and day out interacting with, you know, brilliant people who are singularly kind of aligned around a same mission. My job is to create an environment within, you know, my group where there's hundreds of scientists and clinicians, and unleash that collective genius that can come from working together, right? So it's not up to me to come up with the great ideas, it's up to me to create an environment that will allow scientists at all levels of the organization to contribute equally.
What's your favorite musical artist or soundtrack?
Yeah, I'm a fan of the 80s. I love 80s music.
Let me see if you can guess mine. Let me see. Look at the colors we have on today. Who does that remind you?
Prince?
Yes.
Prince.
He's one of my favorite artists. Well, Rob, thanks for the conversation today, you know?
Yeah, it was great meeting you.
It was great meeting you too.